Well, we're at 1:30 here, so we'll look to get started. Hello and welcome to the third annual Climate Symposium. My name is Ben Ethier. I'm a senior water adaptation and mitigation specialist at the City of Calgary. I'd like to echo the wonderful territorial acknowledgement from yesterday's opening sessions and remind everyone that we are broadcasting from the territorial, or the traditional territories of the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta and the Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3. We acknowledge all Indigenous urban Calgarians who have made Calgary their home. For today's session, we are using the Microsoft Teams live event platform, and the entire session is being recorded. You can access the recording with your link for the next 30 days. Recordings will also be posted to calgary.ca/climatesymposium in the coming weeks. As members of the audience, you will not be able to share your audio or video. However, you can interact with myself and the presenters using the Q&A section. The Q&A button looks like two overlapping speech bubbles with a question mark in it. Let's have a look at the agenda for today. So, following a few opening remarks from me, I'll hand it over to Maggie Nelson for Watershed in a Changing Climate, highlighting the Bioengineering Demonstration and Education Project. Just note there will be a chance for questions at the end. We'll endeavor to answer all your questions, either in the Q&A or by asking the speakers. We apologize in advance if we aren't able to get to your question. Sometimes the Q&As can be very active. On that note, I'd also like to recognize Jillian Curley, who also supports the city's climate program, and Dennis O'Keefe, who will be helping with the Q&A. Both of us will also be posting announcements and links to the resources in the Q&A. I invite you to join the discussion about climate change and this event on social media using the hashtag YYC Climate Symposium. So before handing this over to Maggie, I'd like to take a moment to recognize all the partners in the community who helped spread the word about the Climate Symposium, offered to host sessions, and put on satellite events throughout the week and into the weekend. Now I'd like to thank Maggie for joining us today to contribute her expertise. Maggie Nelson is a public program coordinator in water resources, is the lead of the development of the education plan for the Bioengineering Demonstration and Education Project, which is a joint effort between the City of Calgary and Alberta Environment and Parks, and aims to improve fish habitat and stabilize slopes between Pearce Estate Park and the Inglewood Bird Sanctuary. Again, today's presentation will be about 45 minutes with a Q&A, and I'll finish with a few closing remarks. Please post your questions in the Q&A. Please post your questions in the Q&A through the presentation and we'll gather them to ask on your behalf. Welcome, Maggie. Maggie, invite you to share your content and please include your system audio, unmute your mic and turn on your video.
Can everyone hear me and see my slides? I hope so. So hello and okay, so hello and welcome to Watershed Management in a Changing Climate. My name is Maggie Nelson and I'm a program coordinator with the City of Calgary Water Resources. Today, I am going to talk about how climate change is shifting and amplifying precipitation patterns in Calgary, how watersheds will be affected, and how the city is working to address some of these challenges. I will also be highlighting an exciting new project, the Bioengineering Demonstration and Education Project. I'll start by defining a watershed. A watershed is a basin-like landform that carries water shed from the land after rain falls and snow melts. Another way to describe a watershed is an area of land where precipitation collects and drains off into a common outlet such as into a river, bay, or other body of water. The City of Calgary is located within the Bow River watershed. This watershed includes over 25,000 kilometers of land from the headwaters in Banff National Park to where it meets up with the Old Man River in semi-arid southeastern Alberta. Within city limits, the Bow River watershed includes six major sub-watersheds: Bow River, Elbow River, Fish Creek, Nose Creek, Pine Creek, and the Shepherd Wetland. The creeks and streams are tributaries of the Bow River. Their protection is important to help manage the overall quality of the Bow River in our city and downstream. Next, I'll review some of what we know about climate change. In 2015, at the Paris Climate Conference, many countries around the world agreed upon GHG reductions targets and actions to try to limit the degree of global warming. The red line in this graph shows the projected global temperature increase by the year 2100 if these countries don't carry out any of their agreed upon actions. The black line represents our temperature projection if all countries do carry out their agreed upon actions. As you can see, even with implementation of all agreed upon actions, we still experience an average global temperature increase of approximately 3.5 degrees Celsius by the year 2100, according to widely accepted projections. Right now, we are trending somewhere just below the red line. What this tells us is that the climate is inevitably changing and there will be impacts associated with this change. These projected changes in temperature and precipitation mean more than just shorter winters and balmier days. Using climate models, scientists are able to predict how these shifting climate variables will amplify the likelihood and severity of climate-related hazards. This slide shows Calgary's key climate-related hazards that are being amplified by climate change. They include extreme heat, wildfire and wildfire smoke, drought and drought-like conditions, river and overland flooding, damaging storms, including hail, winter storms, and shifting seasons. All of the hazards on the screen are becoming more likely and more severe because of increased greenhouse gas emissions in our atmosphere. I want to emphasize the fact that climate change is making our precipitation patterns more extreme. Both observation of past precipitation patterns and future climate modeling indicate an upward trend in extreme precipitation events for Calgary. And research indicates an increase in convective storms like thunderstorms, lightning, and hail. A simplified explanation for this increase in intense precipitation events is that warmer air holds more moisture, and so precipitation volumes can increase with increasing temperature. This can lead to extreme rainfall during warm season storms and greater amounts of snow falling in single dumps during cold seasons. Climate change is exacerbating the conditions that lead to river and overland flooding, making the chance of major flooding in Calgary more likely. For example, hotter temperatures and heavier rainfall can trigger more rain on snow events, with warm rains inducing faster snow melt. Climate change is also amplifying the risk of drought-like conditions. This is because of the earlier timing of snow melt in the spring and the higher chance of longer, drier, and hotter summers. For our watershed, this can mean decreases in river water volumes in summer months and a decrease in river water quality. So, what is the city doing? I'll start with flood resiliency. This is a visual representation of key adaptation measures from the Calgary Flood Resilience Plan. The plan uses a three-layered approach: upstream flood protection on the Bow and Elbow rivers to increase water storage and help slow larger flows from the mountains, community level flood protection through the installation and upgrading of permanent infrastructure, and property level flood protection through changes to building regulations and bylaws and limiting the types of development in flood prone areas. I'll give you an example. Has anyone noticed the upgrades completed on the Glenmore Dam? With new improvements to the dam that were completed in time for the spring 2020 flood season, the Glenmore Reservoir can now hold double the volume of water that it used to. Now, the dam can hold back more water during moderate flood events, protecting downstream homes and properties. Plus, the new steel gate system will provide greater flexibility to manage reservoir storage by storing higher levels of water throughout the winter during low river flow periods. So these dam improvements will also help during hot, dry summers. As a bonus, the new bridge deck provides better access for pedestrians and cyclists that use the pathway system. So next up is drought management planning. Planning and preparing for drought is an essential part of the city's water security framework. The water utility has established drought operational guidelines to improve seasonal drought preparedness and actions. The water utility is also assessing future drought risks and vulnerabilities under changing climate scenarios to inform a final drought management plan and a complementary drought education plan, which will guide improved drought management strategies for long-term resiliency. The drought management plan and education plan are expected to be complete in 2022. If drought conditions develop and our drought indicators determine the need for mandatory action to reduce water demand, the city would implement outdoor water restrictions, which progress through four stages as drought conditions become more severe. Finally, I'd like to talk about natural asset protection. At the city, we are also working on projects to better protect and manage natural features in our city, like trees, wetlands, and parks. These natural assets help to prevent stormwater runoff and flooding by absorbing water, and they reduce erosion during flood events. In addition, they keep the city cooler by reducing the urban heat island effect, and they store carbon dioxide, so it's important that we value and protect them. The City of Calgary also recognizes the value that healthy riparian areas play in flood protection and water quality management, and is currently implementing the Riparian Action Program, or RAP. The RAP document is intended to be used by planners, engineers, practitioners, and watershed stewards within the corporation and the community for direction and ideas on how to protect and restore riparian landscapes in Calgary. Riparian landscapes occupy the spaces where land and water interact. They border rivers, creeks, and wetlands and extend across the floodplain, down into the groundwater, and upwards to include plants and trees. A healthy riparian area has a healthy shoreline with deep-rooted native plants that strengthen the riverbank and prevent erosion. Lush and diverse vegetation provides habitat for fish and wildlife, filters sediment, and stores nutrients. So the riparian restoration project I'd like to highlight today is the Bioengineering Demonstration and Education Project, or the BDEP. The BDEP is a joint effort between the City of Calgary and Alberta Environment and Parks and aims to improve fish habitat and stabilize slopes between Pearce Estate Park and the Inglewood Bird Sanctuary, while also providing us with an opportunity to evaluate bioengineering techniques and their use in riparian restoration projects. The goals of the project are to stabilize and protect eroded slopes, improve fish and wildlife habitat, demonstrate and communicate the effectiveness of different bioengineering techniques, and improve the aesthetic value of the area. Bioengineering is the science of using living plants and other natural materials to provide bank stabilization and erosion control. When plant roots and branches grow along the river's edge, they weave together, forming a sturdy network that helps hold soil in place. This organic structure protects the riverbank from erosion. Plant roots help to grab and hold soil, while the plant vegetation helps to slow the flow of water, a two-fold approach preventing further bank erosion. Bioengineering is not a new practice. However, the incorporation of bioengineering technology into stream bank erosion protection or flood mitigation works has been limited in Alberta. So the project is located on the west bank of the Bow River between Pearce Estate Park and the Inglewood Bird Sanctuary. And it's this area here that you see labeled the corridor. The project is divided into three microsites. There were originally five sites that were a part of the project. This gravel bar here was originally site three, but were not included in the final project. And that's why the sites remain 1, 2, and 4 to be consistent with the language of the construction and monitoring documents. So as some of you may be aware, this area underwent a dramatic transformation during the 2013 flood. The flood changed the Bow River and its banks as rushing floodwaters caused significant erosion, widening the river and changing the slope of many riverbanks. The photo on the right shows an area of the site where powerful flows cut the bank back by almost 20 meters. Bank stabilization projects constructed immediately after the flood were driven by the need to protect critical infrastructure and homes and typically applied hard riprap designs. Riprap, a hard engineering technique of placing large angular rocks along the shoreline, was used following the 2013 flood to provide immediate bank protection. The advantage of using bioengineering techniques is that they achieve a number of bank stabilization goals while also creating critical fish and wildlife habitat and improving water quality. So this stretch of bank is now composed of a mix of hard engineering and bioengineering techniques. And this photo was taken from the new BRT bridge lookout last summer. So sometimes you do need riprap. So one question we asked ourselves when planning the BDEP was how can we get the erosion protection of riprap with the ecological value of vegetation? So to help answer that question at site 4, we modified the existing riprap using three different techniques. Soil covered, where we use smaller riprap to create a cap and then covered that with soil and planted native plants. And void filled, where we filled voids with gravel and topsoil and then used potted plants and stakes. So here's an illustration of an area of modified riprap. So you can see where we have riprap as the base layer and then we have the topsoil and plants. And just as a quick aside, when I talk about the word stake, this is what I mean here. So these are pictures of willow stakes that were used on the site. So site 2 used a number of different vegetative or planting methods, including a brush mattress, live staking, and fascines. Here's an illustration of live staking. So these are the stakes right here. And right here at the bottom, this bundle of willows is what we call a box fascine. This is an illustration of a brush mattress right here. And these bundles are called a contour fascine. And then finally, this is an illustration of the head brush layer technique. And now I'm not going into too much detail about any of the techniques used at the BDEP site, but if you are interested, you can find detailed information by visiting calgary.ca/BDEP. At site 1, upstream of the Cushing Bridge, so not in this picture, we installed a new technique where live cuttings were carefully planted into the open spaces between existing or placed riprap. Downstream of the Cushing Bridge, which you can see in this photo, we installed a brush mattress on the slope and a timber crib wall with fish shelters. So a timber crib wall is a structure made of interlocking logs with live vegetation placed between the seams of each layer. The timber structure acts as a retaining wall, which is an effective means of stabilizing steep slopes. We created fish habitat by placing the crib wall on concrete blocks and large rocks. This creates cave-like habitat for bank-loving brown trout. So in this photo, you can see site 1 and the damage that was done by the flood of 2013. And this is site 1 from a photo from last summer. And again, here's site 2 just before we started construction. And a photo of site 2 post-treatment. And here's site 4 pre-treatment. So again, this is the area where the majority of riprap was used following the 2013 flood. And here's a photo of site 4 post-treatment. And this area of riprap at the end here, we left on purpose as a control for our monitoring project. So the City of Calgary is currently undertaking a long-term riparian monitoring program to better understand the long-term riparian health trends. This program includes many flood-affected and subsequently restored sites along riverbanks in the city. A 10-year monitoring plan at the Bioengineering Demonstration and Education Project is part of this program, the Bioengineering Efficacy Monitoring Plan, or the BEMP, because we love acronyms. The BAMP is an important component of the bioengineering demonstration and education project and will provide us with valuable data to support the use of bioengineering techniques as effective and ecologically valuable alternatives to hard engineering practices for bank erosion protection. The aim of this plan is to monitor, evaluate, and report on the effectiveness of the different bioengineering techniques used in the construction of the project. And I'd like to quickly just highlight the lead consultants working on the BEMP and the BDEP. They include Hemera, Terra Erosion Control, Kerwood Lytle Consulting Engineers, Longview Ecological, and Cows and Fish. So what's next? Monitoring will occur for the next 10 years and will include surveys for fish and fish habitat, riparian health, wildlife, and the integrity of the bioengineering structures. Monitoring will be conducted during select seasons in each monitoring year to capture a range of environmental conditions. Pre-construction baseline monitoring of a variety of biotic and abiotic factors and continued monitoring of the project area over the next decade will provide a greater understanding of all aspects of constructing a bioengineering project of this size and scale, from design, development, and construction to maintenance and environmental benefits. And you can find the monitoring results for 2019 at that same website, calgary.ca/BDEP, and the results for the 2020 monitoring year will be posted soon. So what we are seeing is that bioengineering provides the same level of erosion protection as hard engineering techniques, while also providing improved riparian health. And research out of Europe on the life cycle of riprap versus bioengineering practices is telling us that bioengineering has a lower overall carbon footprint than riprap as well. And what I am going to do now is show you a quick video on the project itself. Can someone just let me know if you guys can see the video? Not yet, okay. Sorry, it won't let me scroll down far enough.
The Bioengineering Demonstration and Education Project is a joint effort between the City of Calgary and the Government of Alberta and aims to improve fish habitat and stabilize slopes between Pearce Estate Park and the Inglewood Bird Sanctuary. The project will showcase the many benefits of using bioengineering to work with the river's natural processes while increasing people's understanding of the numerous ways that riverbanks can be stabilized using natural living materials and methods.
Bioengineering is using living plants to provide an engineering function just like we use stone, concrete, or steel. In a river engineering context, we generally use bioengineering for bank stabilization and protection. For example, willow and dogwoods, shrubs, and poplar trees are really good at stabilizing and protecting slopes. The plant roots help to grab and hold the soil, while the stems and branches help to slow the flow of water, a two-fold approach in protecting the bank. The advantage to bioengineering over more structural techniques, such as riprap, is that it's cheaper, more aesthetic, and provides a number of ecological benefits. The bank of the Bow River at this location eroded by almost 50 meters in the 2013 flood, washing out the road, exposing buried pipelines, and jeopardizing the nearby homes. The bank that was left after the 2013 flood was really steep and full of construction debris, which left it at risk for further erosion and a bit of a public safety risk. Bank stabilization projects constructed immediately after the flood were driven by the need to protect critical infrastructure straight away, and typically applied hard engineering solutions like riprap, which are those gray boulders that you see all over the banks of Calgary. With this project, we had a bit more time to assess software engineering solutions like bioengineering. We also took the opportunity to form more of an ecosystem approach to address other issues in the area, such as providing room for the river and addressing a wildlife corridor concerns. Our project objectives were to stabilize the slope to protect city infrastructure, such as the regional pathway, important community corridor, provide room for the river to reduce flood and erosion risk, and restore riparian health and related ecologic functions. We wanted to demonstrate a variety of bioengineering techniques and provide a key wildlife corridor to allow safe animal migration.
The bioengineering demonstration and education project site was divided into 10 different treatment areas where different bioengineering techniques were selected to address different hydraulic factors such as velocities, shear stresses, and scour, and exposure to each of these conditions. Geotechnical conditions such as slope stability, existing infrastructure such as pathways, bridges, parks, roads, outfalls, etc., and environmental considerations such as existing trees, banks, wattle colony, and river features. The techniques that were selected to address these considerations and also to reflect the existing site conditions that we found here. In general, the designs are based on providing rock armor extending to the vegetation trim line to protect against scour, bank erosion, and ice abrasion, and various bioengineering treatments to the top of bank to provide bank protection and improve riparian, aquatic, and terrestrial habitats while also improving aesthetics. The bioengineering demonstration and education project includes three sites. The first site extends from upstream of Cushing Bridge and goes to the first rock groin. Upstream of the Cushing Bridge, we constructed vegetative riprap with rooted flat cuttings as part of the wildlife corridor. Downstream of the Cushing Bridge, we constructed a vegetative timber crib wall and a vegetative timber crib wall with fish. Site, we modified the existing riprap using three techniques: soil covered riprap, void filled riprap with plugs, void filled riprap with live staking. We left the last section of riprap untouched as a control section. Now, the traditional method of bank armoring is using rock riprap, where angular rocks of sufficient size to resist flood velocities are placed together against an eroding bank. Riprap is an effective method for erosion protection and has been used in Calgary quite often in the past, as the rock materials are commonly available to the post of the mountains, and because design and construction methods are well known. Now, there are over 100 riprap sites covering about 30 kilometers of riverbank of the Bow and Elbow Rivers, including the Glenmore Reservoir. That's about 15% of the riverbank on the Bow and Elbow Rivers in Calgary. So riprap is an important approach for emergency and severe conditions. However, it does have low aesthetic and little to no habitat value. Bioengineering approaches can offer the same level of erosion protection than riprap, but they provide additional benefits. These benefits include things like improved habitat through shade, cover, food, and nutrient inputs for fish and other aquatic life, improved riparian health through higher native vegetation diversity and significantly lower invasive species cover, higher level of biodiversities of birds and insects, et cetera, also increased water quality filtering and uptake of nutrients and improved aesthetics. The recent research in Europe on the life cycle assessment of riprap versus bioengineering projects show that the bioengineering projects, they actually have lower overall carbon footprint than riprap to meet the climate change objectives. Also, like we all are very excited about, bioengineering is also generally cheaper. We estimated that using riprap at this site to provide the same level of bank protection would have cost about $1 million more than what we've done here in terms of the bioengineering approaches. Sometimes you do need to use riprap, so how do you get the erosion protection of riprap with ecological value of vegetation? Best case scenario is to include vegetation in the original design, since it is easier to incorporate into the structure when rock is being placed, and it can be placed deeper and potentially into the bank behind the rock. So the options if you have that situation is that you could use a brush layer between riprap layers or live staking within the riprap matrix. Now at the demonstration project, the riprap was previously placed along the downstream end of the site as part of a project that was constructed in 2013-2014. We attempted three methods to retrofit this riprap with vegetation. One technique was covering the riprap with planted material and vegetation. The other two techniques were based on filling the void spaces in the riprap and then planting it with vegetation. From a design and construction perspective, there may be concerns about disturbing the existing structure and vegetation displacing rock. The techniques we selected were meant to maintain the existing structure in its current state, so to let the structure fulfill its original purpose and design intent. Now, with respect to planting vegetation in the riprap, it might be thought that the roots will displace the rock, but plant species typically used grow through and around rocks and do not displace the rock. They actually bind the rocks together, reinforce the structure by tying into underlying soils, provide surface cover and reduction in shear stress. So the excavation of established vegetated riprap sites has shown that roots actually change shape as they grow through small crevices between rocks then they increase back to normal size whenever they get into larger void spaces. Post-construction monitoring is occurring over 10 years at the BDUP site. There are four main components to the monitoring program. Fish and fish habitat, where there are seasonal assessments of fish use, wildlife, breeding bird and nest surveys, and bridge use of the corridor under Cushing Bridge, riparian health assessments based on cows and fish methods, bioengineering structure integrity, using the protocols developed for the riparian monitoring program, where we are assessing structure, material condition, and vegetation survival. It is expected that monitoring of the project area will provide us with a greater understanding of all aspects of constructing a bioengineering project of this size and scale, from design development and construction to maintenance and environmental benefits. There are several interesting learnings to share from the monitoring efforts that we've been conducting at the demonstration project. Firstly, we used rooted live cuttings, which were the first installation in Calgary in the area upstream of Cushing Bridge. The main objective here was to accommodate construction during the summer window for in-stream construction on the Bow River. Woody vegetation is no longer dormant in August and September, and there's generally not enough time for live cuttings to properly establish prior to fall. So based on monitoring data for bioengineering projects across the city, planting live cuttings in summer leads to low survival rates. Using this technique, we found that our survival rates are relatively okay at 65%, but they could be better. After observing the site for a few seasons post-construction, we've observed that the area where the rooted cuttings were planted can be underwater for several weeks of the year. Some species can withstand these conditions better than others, so we learned that the sandbar willow is best under these circumstances versus balsam poplar and red osier dogwood that were also planted there. Secondly, we incorporated seven new techniques into the demonstration project. One of them, the hedge brush layer, involves incorporating species as container plants in a brush layer that do not form adventitious roots like some species of willows do. They are typically placed at one stem per linear meter in the brush layer. The main benefit of including other species is for biodiversity and including fruiting shrubs for wildlife and birds. Another new technique that we used was called a box machine, which is a vegetative technique for toe protection, which we've seen that has worked very well at the site. We've also included seven examples of common techniques that are used in the city of Calgary. We've used a technique called brush mattress, where the success of this technique is variable across the city, as we've seen through other monitoring efforts. BDEP shows that they can be used successfully, as we've seen quite high successful rate here, establishment rates. We've also used a contour machine at the site. We've also included the timber crib wall at the site, where backfill material and compaction specifications, and also material used for containment of the backfill material across the city, is found to be variable through other monitoring efforts. We attempted to provide an example of good materials and practices that could improve the overall design and implementation of timber crib walls across the city. We've also included vegetated soil wraps, which is a good technique that might be underused. Another successful practice that we included in this project was to use soil amendment on the live cuttings. The monitoring program is telling us that fish are using the habitat enhancements that are included in the demonstration project. Wildlife are using the wildlife corridor. The bank swallows have returned back. The riparian health is a proof of the site. In fact, vegetation metrics have increased by between 20 to 250% over background assessments. And the site remains in very good condition overall. Overall survival of the vegetation as planted here is 80% for container plants and live cuttings. Scheduling of the work is very important. In Calgary, the best case is in spring for live cuttings. A summer construction also occurs, but typically using live cuttings is not the best choice. Now we have a good option for summer construction, which are rooted tall stock instead of live cuttings. Vegetation stock handling during construction, including harvest, storage, transport, soaking, and installation, are critical to the success of a vegetation-based project. One of the key aspects of many successful projects observed in the city is contractors were selected who understand and actually follow best practices for handling and installing vegetation. Key takeaways when it comes to maintenance are that irrigation, weeding, and fencing are required to support the vegetation until it establishes. That means that generally up to 3 years of maintenance is required. Deep watering is necessary to support root growth deep into the soil so that once irrigation is completed, the roots are deep and can access the moisture zones in the native soils. Competition between weeds and planted vegetation can result in poor growth or survival for the planted vegetation. Weeding needs to occur before plants go to seed. Some weeds need special treatment when they are removed and disposed of. Fencing is very important to keep the rodents out that will mercilessly eat the plants. Also, fencing will keep the humans and dogs out will trample the vegetation and compact the soils. Plants really need time to properly establish until they can withstand browsing. However, after 3 years or so, some of the willow species respond quite well to coppicing or browsing and grow several stems off the main stem to become much more bushier and provide more cover.
Maintaining and restoring the ecological network is one of the roles of the City of Calgary. The ecological network is the native habitat cores, corridors, and stepping stones that wildlife use throughout the city. The primary wildlife corridors are the Bow and Elbow Rivers, Nose, West Nose, Fish, and Pine Creeks. These are spaces where wildlife can thrive and move throughout the city. To create a more usable area for wildlife, we pulled the vertical bank back in areas and created a flood terrace. Along the terrace and under the bridges, we also put a wildlife trail that moves through the area. We also improved the regional pathway so that it's safer and less prone to flood damage, where it is such a critical and vital commuter corridor for Calgarians. We implemented plans to increase the diversity of and types of plants in the area that support wildlife. These plants were chosen because they are both native to Calgary and found in this area. These plants reflect how the site is situated, its proximity to the river, east and north facing, and with the types of soils we find in Calgary. Over the longer term, these plants will require less maintenance, as well as providing the benefits to nature of shade, nutrients, and places to live.
Fish habitat will be restored by creating innovative fish shelters under new timber crib walls and through strategic placement of boulder clusters. Native plant species will provide vegetative cover on newly stabilized slopes and existing riprap, as well as additional benefits to both fish and wildlife. The overhanging riparian vegetation will act as cover from predators for fish, as well as shade from direct sunlight.
Using living and non-living plant material, bioengineering harnesses the power of nature to provide engineering benefits while creating habitat on land and in water.
Sorry. All right, so to wrap things up, I'd like to say that though climate change is a difficult challenge, I hope that you've heard lots of great solutions at this symposium. I encourage you to get involved and take action in your own way and share what you've learned with your friends, family, and coworkers. Thank you so much for joining me today. And now I'm going to pop things over to Dennis for the Q&A.
Hi there. Thank you, Maggie. So like we said earlier, if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A chat now. I see there's a few questions rolling in right at the end now. I think we will dive in with the first one we have. This one will be for John. Someone was asking, is there a point at which we have to admit some things cannot be saved? What happens then? John, do you think you can answer that one?
Yeah, absolutely. Hi, everyone. My name is John Slaney. I'm a planning engineer with the city's river engineering team. And absolutely. So to restore Calgary to a sort of a natural state, we would have to remove all the upstream dams and essentially move downtown to another location. And that would allow the river to be completely natural again. But realistically, that's just not possible anymore, and probably might not be worthwhile. So having said that, before we go on and take on any real big capital project in the city of Calgary, we always do what's called a TBL analysis, and that stands for triple bottom line. And what we're looking at is not only the economic costs and benefits of a project, but we also look at the social and environmental costs and benefits as well. And by sort of doing that sort of TBL analysis, we come up with a way of determining whether a project is beneficial to move forward or not.
Okay, thank you very much. I will move on to the next question. This one I think also will be good for you to answer, John. So as Jonathan and Mike mentioned, riprap bank protection is extensive throughout Calgary. Are there plans to upgrade existing riprap at any other Calgary sites through integration of bioengineering methods like those demonstrated at Site 4? I understand this is a 10-year monitoring project, but is there opportunity to take action to support biodiversity in the interim? So I'll let you answer that one, John.
Great question. There definitely are plans to look at a lot of the sites that have long, extensive riprapped revetments throughout the city. We do want to wait, as you mentioned, to see how this test location kind of works out, to see which sort of technique provides the best solution and is the most cost beneficial or TBL beneficial of the techniques used. We do have a few other small locations where we are trying similar things, but before we really tackle some of those really larger areas, we want to make sure that we're using the best technique.
Okay, thank you very much for that answer, John. Next question, this one I think is either for you, John, or it might be also for Ben. The next question is, what temperature increase, plus 1.8 degrees Celsius to plus 4 degrees Celsius, what temperature increase will bioengineering be able to withstand with the coming climate change? So, John or Ben, do you guys have an answer for that one?
I can try just to say that all of our native species are pretty well attuned to drought situations. Yes, it will get worse with climate change potentially, and so we hope that all of them will be okay. The other sort of benefit of being in the riparian zone is that they have access to a ready supply of water, that being the river. As long as the river is continuing to provide water to that riparian area, many of them will be absolutely fine. That's kind of the answer.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. One last question. We're getting more questions. Okay. Next question I think is for, I think it might be Maggie, maybe John. Where was willow material sourced for these projects? Or I guess if you don't know for this specific project, if you can just maybe speak to willow sourcing in general.
Yeah, absolutely. I can't speak to the exact locations where we got them. And in many cases, they came from different locations, depending on the species and how much was available. Generally, we have a mandate that they have to be sourced in the same ecoregion, so that we're not getting willows that are established in sort of a BC environment and then coming here and not doing so well. So they all come within a certain radius of the site that they're being used in. And usually they're sourced either at farms. So we have consultants or contractors now that are growing their own willows sustainably. But many of them also come from sort of wild stands that are collected in a responsible way. Many of them, especially along sort of power line right of ways, underneath power lines, is where I've heard that a lot of them are coming from. There is a provincial regulation for cutting down these willows in the wild. So hopefully that answers that question.
Okay, yes, thank you for that answer, John. Our next question goes to, I believe it's going to either fall under John or Maggie. Can you speak to how fish habitat is monitored and how do we assess improvement? So I think a lot of that goes into that 10-year monitoring plan.
Great. Maggie, do you want me to take a first stab at this and then feel free to fill any holes? Awesome. Fish habitat, it's done in a few ways. The first one is just physical monitoring. So we go out before we do a project and we look and set some traps to catch fish. And then we also do something called electrofishing to catch fish. And that gives you sort of an analysis of what kind of species are using that area before you do your project. And then you can do the same sort of analysis afterwards. So again, you float the same area with the changes and you do the electrofishing again and you set the traps again and you see what species you observe and what species you're able to catch in that area. So that's one way of assessing the habitat. And the other way of assessing it is through more of a mapping technique. So there have been studies that have reviewed what species and what life stage of certain fish like certain types of habitat. So whatever the velocity is, whatever the water depth is, whatever the substrate is, whatever that change in types of habitat are. And so there are actually curves that show the value of different ranges of habitat. And so by knowing, going through the site before the project's done and mapping it in a way that shows you what the velocity is and shows you what the depth is and all those different factors, you can then come up with what's called a weighted habitat unit. And that's, and And so that's more of a desktop analysis to review sort of the quality of the habitat. And if you do that pre and post construction, you can assess the change. And that's kind of the direction that the city is going, especially for sort of larger projects like this.
The only thing that I would add on to John's answer is that you can see the current monitoring reports on calgary.ca/BDEP by clicking on the link for the bioengineering efficacy monitoring plan. And in that report, there's a summary report as well as a technical report. And in there, you can see the data that was taken from the monitoring that occurred prior to construction and then post-construction in 2019. And then later this year, you'll be able to see the data from 2020 as well.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Maggie. Just looking at the Q&As now and looking at our time as well, I think that if you have any more questions, you can throw them in here right at the end. Otherwise, I think we are ready to wrap things up. So what I will do is I will send let Ben take over the closing for the presentation. Sorry, my apologies. We had one question that ended up in the wrong spot. So there's one more question. This one is going to be for John. This one's around sediment in the river. Have you ever considered the idea of removing excess sediments and reusing them in filling depleted shores due to regular water action? Or maybe even create artificial islands that could use native growing vegetation to maintain the structures for these riverbanks or islands? So it's kind of a long question, but yeah, I'll leave that one up to you, John.
Yeah, no, that's a really great question, and touches on to the fact that, you know, rivers have flows of water, but they also have flows of sediment. And sometimes that sediment deposits in locations, as the question alludes to, that aren't so beneficial. So right now there's a fairly large gravel bar that's formed just downstream of Center Street Bridge, and it's currently vegetating into it's going to be a big riparian forest again, which has some flood concerns in that, you know, it will reduce the capacity of the river at that important point. So the city has a project where we're looking at what would be the best way of removing that that gravel and then going and reintroducing it to the river further upstream, where we may be lacking gravel and which is important for fish spawning. So a lot of the fish use gravels to spawn in, but also it helps stop the river from continuing down cutting and stops the bank, which helps prevent the banks from falling in after the fact. So absolutely, we have considered that and are looking to apply it in a couple key locations along the rivers in Calgary.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you for your answer there, John. So like I said, that's the end of the questions that have been posted. So I'm going to pass things off to Ben to wrap things up for us.
Thanks, Dennis. I'd like to thank Maggie for sharing her insights and time with us today, and John for his technical expertise. Thank you all as well for joining us today, and be sure to visit calgary.ca/climatesymposium to register for other sessions. To learn about actions you can take to help limit climate change and to prepare for a changing climate, visit calgary.ca/climateaction. We'll be sending out a short survey. There's a link to it in the chat too. We would appreciate your feedback about this session. Thanks again for taking the time to join us today.